William Gurstelle was named to the Wired magazine. Who reads Wired magazine when I can? He was named to their list of their smart list. He's a two-time TED speaker, best-selling author, registered engineer, professional speaker, and he's currently a contributing editor at Popular Science and Make magazines. You may see him on the Discovery Channel, and he's traveled the world on both speaking and writing assignments from places as far-flung as Tierra del Fuego, Borneo, Spitsbergen, and of course the Yukon, yay Alaska. And today he'll be exploring the idea of smart risk-taking with us. And this is intended to be an interactive session, and I think we can give him our complete assurity that this is a very participatory group. We are mostly by nature. So with that, and I would also mention that Mr. Gurstelle is coming to us in spite of a cold. So with that, I'd ask you to help join me in welcoming to the stage.
Okay, thank you very much. It's great to be here. Can everybody hear me okay? Good. I'm here to talk about what I call the art of living dangerously. It's a topic I think about a lot and I give talks about a lot. I want to start out by telling you a little bit about how I came to know something about this topic. Now, I don't usually spend a lot of time going through myself, talking about myself and why I talk about this topic, but in order for me to have any sort of credentials with you, I want to explain a little bit about where I came from in terms of my risk-taking exploration. About 12 years ago now, I wrote the book called Backyard Ballistics. Now, probably most of you have never heard of it, but this was a book I wrote out of nowhere. The very first book, I was an engineer, I didn't do any writing, but I wrote this book. And I never thought I'd find a publisher because it's basically a book of PG-13 science experiments. Everything's a little dangerous in it. You know, people go, oh, you're the guy who writes about blowing stuff up. And no, I'm not. I'm the guy who writes about science and technology and the wonder of exploration and risk-taking. But it is, it became a very popular book. Believe it or not, it sold nearly 500,000 copies. That's a lot of copies of the book. And I said, well, this is great. I'm not going to be an engineer anymore, I'm going to be a writer. So I started writing other books, and I've written 6, 7, 8 books now since Backyard Ballistics came out. But here's the thing, none of those books ever sold like Backyard Ballistics, okay? Too bad. But I'm going, why? Why didn't those other books sell, you know, to the extent that this one did? So I made it my job, my undertaking to figure out what it was about Backyard Ballistics that made it so popular. And basically, it was a book about risk-taking, but fun risk-taking. The projects in Backyard Ballistics smack of danger. They smack of risk-taking. And I said, okay, I'm going to explore this topic. So I wrote another book on that topic, and it's called Absinthe and Flamethrowers, Ruminations on the Art of Living Dangerously. And when this book came out, it did pretty good, too, and I got a lot of attention. It got written up in the Wall Street Journal. The New York Times did a whole article on me. I'm not here to brag. I just want to let you know this book did well. The London Telegraph wrote it. People started to talk about Absinthe and Flamethrowers and the Art of Living Dangerously. In fact, I started to write about this topic, and I started to write this topic for various magazines. And one magazine I wrote for liked what I did so much that they put me on their masthead as the contributing editor. This is Popular Mechanics. And you can see they have what they call their special editors there. And the top one is Jamie Heineman and Adam Savage. Those are the Mythbusters. You've seen them. And below that is Jay Leno, because he does their car thing. And who's below that? Me! So, I mean, I thought, well, this is great. I'm actually getting some recognition. So, anyway, that's how I came to know something about the topic I'm going to start with right now. Who is this? Who recognizes who this is? Shout it out if you know who it is. Somebody, take a guess. It's young Thomas Edison, okay? When Thomas Edison was a young boy, he didn't have a lot of money. So what he did was he took a job on a train that went from Detroit to Huron, Michigan. And every day, he would sell newspapers and candy on this train. He was what was called a candy butcher, which was a young man who would sell stuff to passengers on the train. And young Thomas Edison, he was a heck of a candy butcher because he would sell out his newspapers and his candy early on in this trip, back and forth, back and forth. So he had nothing to do. So what did he do? He went back into the baggage car and he set up his own chemistry lab. And he'd be back there in this baggage car while the train's going back and forth. And he had a pretty good life. He liked it until he accidentally blew up the baggage car and he got fired. So that kind of ended his career as a candy butcher, but he went on to do wonderful things. Now, you're not going to anybody recognize this? I doubt it. Who is it? Oh, they're better than, yeah, terrific. It is. It's Galileo. Now, this is Galileo, and from his youngest days, from when he was a young boy, he was also a risk taker, physical and intellectual risk taker. Now, you wouldn't think about it. You wouldn't think this, but originally, Galileo's ideas, the invention of the telescope, what revolved around what, was pretty dangerous business, because in the climate in which he lived, the time in which he lived, he actually risked getting burned at the stake because the church said that what you're teaching is heresy, it's wrong. So in order for him to promulgate his ideas, he took a certain amount of risk. And in fact, he was confined to his house under house arrest for the last several years of his life. But he never gave up his ideas of science and of taking risks to do what he believed in. Okay, I bet you know who this is. Who's this? Amelia Earhart, one of the most well-known women, in fact, person, man or woman, of the first half of the 20th century. Amelia Earhart was a famous, they use this quaint term, aviatrix, a female aviator, which they don't use anymore. But she earned the Distinguished Flying Cross, first woman to do that, first woman to fly solo across the Atlantic. When she was popular, she was on the magazine covers of every magazine. Everybody knew who Amelia Earhart was. Growing up, she spent long hours playing kind of masculine sports. She would hunt rats with a rifle. She would, you know, belly slam down hills. She was quite a tomboy. I came across this picture when I was researching my topic. This is her house back where she lived. And what she had done, I think her father took this picture. She had rigged up this sled kind of track from her tool shed to the bottom. And then she would take a wagon and put it on those tracks and zoom down. And so she did this. And I think the first time she did it, it went okay. But the second time she did it, not so good. She boom, came down, she tore her dress, split her lip. But what did she say when she came out of it? I have a question. She says to her sister, "Oh, sister, that was just like flying." That was very inspiring to her. And those are three people who are examples of people who were willing to take a risk, take a chance. And they did that from a very early age. They started taking risks early, and they got better at it by practicing. Risk-taking, now let me tell you what I mean by risk-taking. It's kind of a vague term. What does Bill mean by risk-taking? Risk-taking specifically in my context means the willingness to put yourself in A, physical danger, B, to make mistakes, and C, advocate unpopular positions and tackle challenging problems that don't have obvious solutions. That's taking a risk in this context. Is that a good thing to do? Well, I believe it is. I believe that's a very good thing to do. Because if you do take those kinds of risks, you grow as a human. You grow as a person. But also, the organization in which you belong to, in fact, the world as a whole, they're all better for it. They're all better for wise risk-taking. Okay. Now, what I'm going to talk about for the next few minutes came directly from my book, Absinthe and Flamethrowers. Now, when I wrote that book, I did a lot of research. And what I wanted to do was interview the best risk-taking scholars in the world. There's two of them that really stand out. One is a guy named Frank Farley, and he's at Temple University in Philadelphia. And the other is a now retired professor at the University of Maryland named Marvin Zuckerman. And I interviewed both these gentlemen for my book, and I said, what can you tell me about the scientific essence, the nature of risk-taking? What I found out was very interesting. I found out a lot of interesting things, but this is one of my favorites. You know how, like, if you take an IQ score, you get a number that says how smart you are via that person or this person. Well, you can get that same kind of quantitative number for your risk-taking proclivity. Instead of called an IQ score, it's called a T score. Now T, you can kind of think of it for thrill-seeking, but it's not really that, it's just a number, T. Your T score is a number that tells you where you are right now versus all the other humans in the world in your willingness, your proclivity to take risks. A T score is a measure of how big a risk taker you are, but we'll see in just a couple minutes that it's not necessarily how good a risk taker you are. Now, I'm going to apologize for what's coming up next, because believe me, I don't like statistics and math either. But in order to go any farther, I got to cover a little bit of statistics, so what follows is going to make some sense. Let's look at this curve. And what do we see? Well, we see a symmetrical curve, that is, the left half and the right half are mirror images of one another. What else do we see about this particular curve? Well, the center is way higher than the tails, and it's not straight, it's curved. Okay, this is a very special curve, and all you mathematicians there probably are already aware that it has a special name. It's called, what's it called? The bell curve. Technically, it's called a Gaussian curve. Sometimes you'll hear it called as a normal curve, and more often than not, you'll hear it called a bell-shaped curve. And it's important to know some things about the bell-shaped curve. The x-axis represents some event occurring, okay? For instance, this is a person who's 9 feet tall, and this is an event of a person, the event being a person who's 5 feet tall. The y-axis represents how frequently that event occurs. Now, what's interesting is that human traits typically follow this normal distribution. If we got lined up all the men by height, we'd find out that most of the men are somewhere around 5 feet 10 to 5 feet 11. There are some 6-footers, 6'4" footers. There's probably some short people over here. And if we looked at how frequently those heights show up, well, they really peak right around 71 inches for men and about 66 inches for women. There's a lot more people in the middle of the curve. There's a lot of human traits that follow this. I don't want to get into genetics too much, but we are controlled by our genes, and any characteristic of a human that is controlled by two or more genes, they're called polygenetic traits, they follow normal distributions. Our IQs, they're controlled by several genes. So if we were to draw a distribution of our IQs, it follows a bell-shaped curve. If we were to all run around Snow King Resort, some of us would get there really quickly, some of us would take a long time, but most of us would kind of get there at the same time. That's a bell-shaped curve. The bell-shaped curve is for height, it's for IQ, it's for athletic ability. There's just so many things that in humans that follow a bell-shaped curve. So is it surprising to you that risk-taking also follows a normal distribution? This is sort of the distribution of our risk-taking proclivity given by T-scores, that one number like IQ that sums up our risk-taking proclivity. There's some people who are very tiny risk-takers. There's some people who are crazy risk-takers. These people here, well, they're like heroin addicts with a death wish. And the people down there, they get beat up by Quakers. But most of the people in the middle, most of us are somewhere in the middle. I can name a lot of famous big T people, a lot of famous risk takers. You know, they're the astronauts, they're the race car drivers, they're people that you've heard of. Down there, not so much. There's just not a lot of famous, really small T risk-taking people. I mean, I can name you fictional ones, Felix Unger, J. Alfred Prufrock, but there's not a lot of real famous small T risk takers. Most of us fall around the middle. Okay, so what? Now I'm going to come to the point of my entire talk. And if you buy this, just say, I buy it, we can all go home, or you can have an extra 45 minutes to goof off. Here's the deal. Is there an area under that curve that it's really extra good to be in? Yes. It's called the golden third. Between average and one standard deviation to the right of average is an area on that risk-taking scale that has the most advantage. Not, and that doesn't mean that if you're in this area on your risk-taking score, you're in great shape, and if you're not in there, you're doomed to a life of boredom and whatever. But there is an area, which I call the golden third, between normal, or between the average and one standard deviation to the rest, that's 34% of the population, where people seem to be happier, they report themselves as happier. It's an area of slightly greater than average risk-taking. These are people who take sensible, rational risks. They're a bit bold, but they're not crazy. Okay, if you believe that, we could just go. But if you don't, let me prove it to you, and I'm gonna prove it to you in three ways. First, let's leave here. Last time I said this, I said, well, let's leave here and go to the Amazon rainforest. This is a group of people called the Yanomama. They were studied by a University of Michigan sociologist named Napoleon Chagnon. And they live on the border between Venezuela and Brazil in these really remote places. And these are a people whose society is not industrialized. Here's the thing that Napoleon Chagnon found out about these people. They're really big risk takers. In fact, they risk life and limb every day. More than a third of Yanomamo men die in combat with other Yanomamo men. They're really sort of like crazy off-the-wall risk-taking types. Chagnon wrote a book, and he called the book The Fierce People, and they really are fierce people. Now, what I said was is that because they're so violent, the men who have killed other people have been given a special name in Yanomamo society. They're called Unakai, Unakai. And when he studied the Unakai, the men who were the biggest risk takers of all, he found out that they had three times as many wives and four times as many children as those who were not Unakai. These big time risk takers just procreated a lot. So what does that mean? Well, if you look at the Yanomamo as a window into our own pre-industrial past, you can see that we, you, me, we're all descended from 1,000 generations of risk takers, the people who are, it's sort of hardwired in our genes, those people who left the cave and went out there to find their way and become what we are today. That's in our, it's in our genetics. We're sort of hardwired to take risks. Okay, I know what you're thinking. You don't live in a rainforest. Tell me something about people like ourselves. Okay, this topic has been studied by others. There were two Canadian professors that wrote a book. They were at the University of British Columbia. And they looked hard at the question of success in business and the willingness to take risks. Their name was McCrimmon and Waring. And they interviewed 500 C-level, CEOs, CFOs, CMO level people at all sorts of Canadian American corporations. And what they found out was fascinating. They wrote a book this thick, but I'm gonna summarize that book in one sentence. Success among these CIOs was associated with a higher level of risk-taking. And that's based on a lot of research that these two Canadians did. I want to tell you that my presentation is online, and I'm going to give you a URL to go to, so you don't have to take copious notes if you don't want to. Anyway, I'm going to just read the quote from their book. More than 500 top-level business executives were studied. Data gathered on numerous socioeconomic variables, including ones relating to personal, financial, and professional characteristics. When these characteristics were subjected to factor analysis, the results were clear-cut. The most successful executives were the biggest risk-takers. The most mature executives were the most risk-averse. So yeah, as you grow older, you also are less willing to take risks. I mean, there's all sorts of things that factor into this. And I'm oversimplifying, you know, a three-month course in an 90 minutes, but we're going to get there one way or the other. I have one last proof for you of my contention that living in that golden third is where you want to be. The Germans, who are really known for being very careful in their studies, did a huge, and I mean a huge, survey of the German, of the country of Germany. And I think it was something like 600,000 questionnaires were mailed out and analyzed to the people of Germany. And they ask all these questions on the German people's proclivity for taking risks. And then they analyzed it and came up with various conclusions. One, I mean, some of these conclusions were not all that surprising. Those people who took the most risks also got the most speeding tickets or most traffic tickets. Okay, you kind of figure that makes sense, right? But the main thing is that they found that there was a strong positive association between life satisfaction and the willingness to take risks. That means they were happier. Those people who would take some risks in life, as opposed to those who eschewed, who didn't take any risks in their life at all, they tended to be happier. Now, let me tell you right now, does that mean that if you're willing to take risks, you're going to be a happy person? No. If you're not willing to take risks, does that mean you're a sad person? No. We're just talking on the average, what this study found, like the other studies, there was a strong positive association between life satisfaction, happiness, if you will, and the ability to take risks. Okay, that's Bill's point. And I know what you're thinking now. Where do I fall? Where am I on right now? You want to know where you are. Where are you? We're going to do that. We're going to look at this question three ways. So by the time you leave here, you're going to have some idea of where you stand on the risk-taking continuum. The first one is the most fun and by far the least accurate. It's called the ring finger test. Hold up your hand, everybody. Sorry about that. I'm going to try and control that volume, but I get excited about this. Hold up your hand. Okay, believe it or not, people say, this is crazy. Can this really be true? It is, and I've got stuff to prove it to you. If you take the ratio of your index finger to your ring finger, okay, the shorter your ring finger is in relationship to your index finger, it's called the 2D4D ratio, the bigger the risk taker you are. What? Does that make sense at all? Well, yeah. Here's why. When you were in your mother's womb, you are exposed to various hormones from your mother. The more androgen, if you're a male, or more estrogen, I'm just going to say hormones because I'm not exactly sure about the ratio. The more hormones that you're exposed to in utero, the bigger that 2D4 ratio becomes. Okay? So even before you're born, you're exposed to these ratios, and it affects not only what kind of risk taker you are, what your finger ratio is, but what kind of risk taker you are. What proof do I have of that? Well, they did this study. I love these studies. They went to the London Stock Exchange, and they got all these traders, and they said, traders, let me see your hand. And they looked at their hands, and they measured it. And you can't really do it without training, but they looked at all these fingers. And they said, okay, the London stockbrokers who took the biggest risks and lasted the longest in the pits, guess what? Shortest 2D4D ratio. Then they went and found women basketball players, and they measured their indexes too. And they said, okay, those that got a lot of fouls in the paint, really aggressive players, same thing, low 2D4D indexes. So let's say you're meeting somebody for the first time and you want to get an idea of what kind of risk taker they are. You stick your hand out and you kind of, I don't know about you. Okay, so maybe now you know exactly what kind of risk taker you are. No, you don't, because I'm going to give you a second, more concrete method. It's called the MIT CR test. Okay, here, this is going to be interactive. I'm going to read you three questions. Do not shout out the answers. This is for you only. Do not say anything. Here's the first question. I'm going to read three questions. I'm going to read each question twice. Okay, do not call out the answers. Here's question one. A bat and a ball cost $1.10 in total. The bat costs $1 more than the ball. How much does the bat cost? Okay, I'll give you a second to think about that. Okay, here's question two. if it takes five machines 5 minutes to make five widgets, how many minutes would it take 100 machines to make 100 widgets? I'll read it a second time, then we go on. If it takes five machines 5 minutes to make five widgets, how many minutes would it take 100 machines to make 100 widgets? Okay, got it? All right. Here's the third and last question. Here is the third and last question. In a lake, there is a patch of lily pads. Every day, the patch doubles in size. If it takes 48 days for the patch to cover the entire lake, how many days would it take for the patch to cover half the lake? Okay, those are the three questions, and you've got your answers, and you're locked in. Let's look at the answers. Well, here are the obvious answers. A bat and ball cost $1.10 in total. The bat costs $1 more than the ball. How much is the bat? It's $1. If it takes five machines 5 minutes to make five widgets, how many minutes would it take 100 machines to make 100 widgets? 100 minutes. And in a lake, there's a patch of lily pads. Every day, the patch doubles in size. If it takes 48 days for the patch to cover the entire lake, how many days to cover half? 24 days. Those are all obvious answers, and they're all wrong. Every one of those is wrong. These are the correct answers, and you can work those out if you want to on your own. For instance, in question two, if it takes nine women 9 months to make nine babies, you know, how long would it take 100 women to make 100 babies? Still 9 months. That part doesn't change. Okay. What does this have to do? Well, okay, this test was developed by a man named Shane Fredericks at MIT. And it's not a test of your intelligence. It's a test of your ability to reflect on an answer before giving it. It's called the cognitive reflection test. And I'm not going to embarrass anybody by saying, did you get them all right or get them all wrong? I just want you to know that the more questions that you got right, the bigger the risk taker you likely are. And why do I say that? Because Shane Fredericks went one step farther than just coming up with this test. He correlated it to a second question. If I went up to this lady here and I said, I'm going to make a deal with you. I'm going to either give you $100 right now, or I'll give you a 75% chance at $200. Which would you take? The smart money says, well, 75% chance at $200 is better than the $100 for sure. But most people wouldn't do that. But when you ask that question to people after they took that test, he found out. Look at this linear correlation. The more people that answered those questions right, the more people that would stop and cognitively reflect, the more willing they were to take that risk. So there was a definite correlation between at least financial risk-taking and your ability to stop and reflect on a question before answering it. Okay, let's move on to the third and last one. You were given a test in the pre-conference materials, were you not? And you took them. Okay. That is a version of the psychological test that was first developed by Marvin Zuckerman at the University of Maryland. It's called the Sensation Seeking Scale 6. And basically, it's a test that asks you questions about risk-taking, and it's been given to thousands and thousands of people, mostly college students, but that's the way that is. And what I want to do is basically talk about how you match up on that test versus the world as a whole. Now, before we go in there and look at your scores versus, you know, the general sample, I want to remind you that this is not just a random sample of people here. We're actually fairly homogeneous in a lot of ways. So my feeling is that we're going to skew towards the right in our risk-taking proclivity as a group from the start, because we're kind of riskier than, you know, think about the jobs you took, basically. So you're not going to be kind of bell-shaped. But in any event, you've written, taken that skills inventory. You know, do you want to drive a race car? Do you want to drive a mountain? Do you want to go to the moon? What do you want to do? There's things that your experience inventory that you've already done and your intentions for the future. Let's first look at your scores for experience, the things you've already done. It's broken up between males and females. For males, this is on the experience side. If you're between basically 22 and 28, you fall somewhere within the golden third versus all the other people in the world in terms of your risk-taking, at least according to sensation-seeking scale 6. If you're a female, if you're between 20 and 24, that would put you in the golden third. That is the experience inventory. Now, here's your intention scores. And if you're somewhere between 45 and 54 as a male, you're in the golden third. And if you're in the female, somewhere between 41 and 50, you're probably in that golden third as well. Okay, so now I've given you 3 ways to know what kind of risk taker you are. You know, you can look at your fingers. You've taken the cognitive reflection test and scored that. And now you've taken your own experience inventory versus a larger group of people. And you're starting to have some very imperfect idea, but at least a little glimmer of insight into your own risk-taking proclivities. I'm going to summarize what we've done so far. We know that different people have different risk tolerances, and like an IQ score, your risk tolerance can be summarized into a single measure called the T-score. About 1/3 of people are between average and slightly higher than average in their risk-taking proclivity, and that's an area called the golden third. Now you're thinking, I'm not in the golden third, maybe. How can I get, move in there? Or just, you want to become a better risk taker. You get better at taking risks through practice. So I've come up with 3 ideas for you that you can practice when you want to, you have to do something that puts you outside your comfort zone. Let's take a risk. Well, you can do something you may not already be good at. For instance, you can sing in public. And now there's 3 types of risks in the world. There's emotional risk, like this. There's financial risk. And there's physical risk. Now this is emotional risk, except in the Philippines. In the Philippines, if you go to a karaoke bar and sing My Way, you are taking your life in your hands. Because there's this thing about singing My Way, the Frank Sinatra song, where people will actually come up and attack you if they don't like the way you're doing it. And it is now against the law in the Philippines to sing My Way in a karaoke bar. Here's another idea for you. You can drink adventurously. It's something I like to do. The title of my book was Absinthe and Flamethrowers. So I said, well, I'm going to start to drink adventurously. Yeah, it's a tough life, but somebody's got to do it. So it used to be, okay, there's a drink called Absinthe. And it was a drink that was very popular around the turn of the 19th to 20th century. And all over Europe, people would stop what they were doing at 5 o'clock. It was called the green hour, 5 o'clock. And they would crowd into the bars. And they would start to drink a particular alcoholic beverage called absinthe. And absinthe was special. For one thing, it has a really high alcoholic content. And back in those days, it had a second psychotropic drug in it called thujone. So people would drink their absinthe, and they would just become sort of these dissipated Parisians, like Toulouse-Lautrec, like just kind of lying there at the bar, not doing anything. And it was such a problem that the powers that be said, this particular alcoholic beverage is too dangerous for the average person. So they outlawed it in France, and they outlawed it in Germany and in the Netherlands. And soon you couldn't get it anywhere except in Spain and Bohemia, and those are bad place. They weren't good absinthe. You couldn't get it at all. It was illegal, too dangerous for people. Recently, though, absinthe has made a comeback. It is now legal to buy in this country absinthe without the thujone concept. But when you drink it, you're sort of taking a risk, and you're kind of showing that you're not afraid to try something new. But if you drink it excessively, believe me, you'll know the next day. The third thing, and the more serious thing, it's kind of risky, but you should re-explore a belief that you hold deeply, at least in my opinion. By doing that, you become a better risk taker. If you think about it in terms of what you do at the national park, you have a lot of beliefs on sort of your work. And there's always questions that come up. You can be for preservation or for development. You can be for access, to a mountain, or you can close that mountain and say, no, it's safety is paramount. You can be involved in naming disputes. But what I'm trying to advocate here is looking at it from the opposite perspective. That's a way to sort of grow in your risk-taking abilities. You could get new ideas, and I think that's kind of an intellectual risk-taking proposition. looking at it from the other side, which is why I have a picture of Plato there, is that's a good, looking at it from both sides is sort of a good way to involve yourself in, how can I put this in risk-taking format? It's a good way to reevaluate something and make yourself uncomfortable and therefore take a risk. Okay. Nobody knows what this is. I won't even ask. This is a picture of a marine animal called a sea squirt. Now, if you have a boat in the ocean, you have to scrape off barnacles. You also have to scrape off sea squirts because what they do is they attach to rocks on the bottom of boats and they just sit there all day. They're filter feeders. They just feed plankton out of the water. You know, they just sit there. They don't do anything. They just sit there all day and feed stuff. Now, the thing is, these animals have no predators. They taste terrible. There's nothing in the ocean that wants to mess with a sea squirt. There's just no reason. They taste bad. Ugh. But when they're juveniles, they look like this. Okay, they're mobile, they're active, they have that little white thing. And the thing about juvenile sea squirts is they're delicious. Everything in the ocean wants to eat a juvenile sea squirt. So when they're juveniles, they have those white things. Well, that's their brain, okay? And they have a brain so they can avoid the danger. But they go through a metamorphosis where they actually eat their own brain when they become adults. They have these adults, whoops, sorry. I went the wrong direction. When they're adults like this, they have no brain, okay? They don't need a brain. They have no danger in their life. I guess that's my point. You have a brain. You have an intellect, mainly, well, not mainly, but you have a brain in your head to help you avoid danger, to cope with danger. If there is no danger in your life, you don't need a brain. So you can make a choice, you know? Do I want to be an adult sea squirt or a juvenile sea squirt? Brainless? Do I want to have danger in my life? Do I want to go out there? What I'd like you to do now is I've learned that nobody can stand to listen to anybody talk for more than 45 minutes without going crazy, no matter how fascinating that particular speaker is. So what I want to do is give you 5 minutes to collect yourselves, to take a bath, hygiene break, or whatever else you need. And then, but just 5 minutes, because I've got a lot more to cover and not much time to do it in. So take five, and then we'll resume in exactly 5 minutes from now.
This is compared to this.
So a longer third finger would indicate greater risk taking.
Who is this? Anybody recognize this woman? Nope. Okay. Well, she lived around the turn of the 20th century. Her real name, but not the name she's most famous by, is Elizabeth Jane Cochran. And among other things, she invented the 55-gallon oil drum. And she was a newspaper journalist and a muckraker. Any guesses? It's Nellie Bly. Nellie Bly. One of the most famous women of the early 20th century. She went on a trip at the behest of her employer, a New York newspaper, to see if she could go around the entire world in 80 days. Well, it was a big deal at the time because there were no jet planes. Could she do it? Could she do it? She captured the imagination of the entire American public. People bought so many newspapers. It was a great success for her and for the newspaper company that sponsored her. Now, when you checked into the hotel, who brought a suitcase? Here. Okay. So when she went on her trip, she fit everything in a tiny valise, this big, for 80 days. This is the thing she carried. It was hardly anything. There's hardly a change of clothing there. But what a great adventurer she was. Nellie was the kind of person it was the journey for her, not winding up somewhere. I'm kind of going faster because I'm short on time here, but she was the archetypical kind of traveler that I call the adventurer. She knew where she wanted to go, but she didn't know how she was going to get there. She didn't mind being uncomfortable, as that was just part of the adventure. There are three types of travelers that you'll encounter at your national parks, and I call them the adventurer, like Nellie Bly, the sojourner, and the vacationer. Each one is different, and each one wants different things when they travel. Let me show you a very different kind of traveler archetype. This is Thomas Cook. You've heard of Thomas Cook. Thomas Cook basically invented modern travel. He came up with the idea of the first guided tours. He came up with the idea of traveler's checks. He came up with the idea of hotel reservations. He came up with the idea of guidebooks. So much of what we associate today with modern travel is a result of Thomas Cook. And why is that? Thomas Cook realized that, I'm going to skip ahead to there, that people, when some people, not all people, but a great amount of people when they travel, do not want to travel like Nellie Bly. They don't want to be on their own. They're not seeking high adventure. They're seeking relaxation. They want to know what they're in for before they go. Now, there's a third kind of traveler, and they were typified by two people who you probably don't know, Osa and Martin Johnson. Anybody heard of Osa and Martin Johnson? Really? Well, I hardly ever get anybody's ever heard of them. Oh, you're from Kansas. They were like the very first travel bloggers. Basically, they went around the world and recorded what they did using movies. And they would go to Africa, and they would go to the Polynesian Islands, and they would take movies of what they did, and they would show it back in movie theaters all over the world. Back in the 1920s and early 1930s, they were the it couple. They were as popular as Tom Cruise or Oprah Winfrey. These were really well-known people. Now, Martin and Osa were adventurous travelers, but not adventurous like Nellie, and they weren't at all like Thomas Cook either. They kind of knew where they were going, and they would spend some time in a place, but they were in the middle. They were those golden third kind of people. All three of these types of travelers were great in their own respect, and each exemplify a travel style, and each travel style is based on the traveler's adventure-seeking propensity. I think it's kind of fun for this group to sort of adventure type National Park Service visitors. You know, we already know that adventure-seeking, risk-taking, follows that normal curve. So it only makes sense that the people who come into the national park also follow that kind of travel-seeking propensity. There's half your visitors are going to be like Thomas Cook. They're kind of like guided people, guided tour people. They know what they want to see. They may have seen it before. They're not looking always for novelty and high adventure. They want to stay within their comfort zone, and they like the idea of falling into a pleasant routine. They like things to be organized, and they like to stay on schedule. They're happy to revisit things they've seen before. There's the Osa Johnson people, who are these risk takers that are between average and one standard deviation to the right of the curve. These are people who like occasionally moving beyond their comfort zone. They seek a mix of action and relaxation, and they like, but don't exclusively like, new experiences. They're willing to put up with a bit of hardship as long as it's not too much. Those are about a third of the people who are going to visit your parks. And then there's that 16% or so that are really adventurous, the Nellie Bly style of travel. They often figure out travel arrangements on the fly. They often don't work well on a formal schedule, and they actively seek out new experiences. If you look at it, they kind of fall, these people, into the same risk curve, because this is the risk curve for humans as a whole. I can't guarantee these numbers, but this is what I think you're going to see in the parks. Basically, 35 to 60% of the people who come there are those Thomas Cook kinds of people. They may not even get out of the car, but a lot of them will, and they'll want to take it easy, but they want to see the highlights, and you got to make experiences that adapt to them. And those are most of your visitors. That's just the way the world is. There's going to be 30 to 40% of your visitors who are more like Osa Johnson, Osa and Martin. You know, they kind of like some adventure, but they're not climbing mountains. And then you've got the Nellie Bly types, the great adventurers, and they probably will be climbing up to the top of Angel's Landing, or they're going to be doing things that are, you know, not for everybody, but you got to remember them when you design experiences, park experiences, for the whole group. Now, what I want to talk about is how, in the few minutes I have remaining, is how you would design those experiences to suit all those different groups of people. You've talked about just, anyway, this is Curly. Remember Curly from that movie? So what does Curly say? You got to remember, you got to find that just that one thing. And it's different for everybody. Have you talked about that yet? Has anybody brought up Curly during the, you're doing a thing on just one thing and you haven't talked about Curly? For those of you who don't know, this is a movie called City Slickers with Billy Crystal, thank you. And they, you know, this is Jack Palance, the trail boss. And he looks at him and says, you got to find that one thing in your life, that one thing that makes a difference. And it's different for everybody. So what makes a place or experience truly great? That's the one thing I want to take away. There's four attributes when you design an experience at your park for their visitors that make a truly great experience. Attribute one, it pushes people right to the right on that T-score. It challenges them. It doesn't have to be physical. You can ask really hard questions in your interpretive examples, but you gotta be able to push people, maybe make them a little uncomfortable. That experience is gonna be remembered. Two, it takes effort to get that reward. Okay, has anybody ever been to Paris and climbed the steps to the top of Montmartre? It's beautiful up there, but it's like 200 steps, it's a lot of work. If you just took the elevator up and look out over Paris, great. But if you take that, make that effort to get all the way up to the top, that's really memorable. Is there anybody here from Mesa Verde? Okay, so I did the balcony house tour. I mean, you gotta climb up this scary 32-foot ladder. I remember that. Everybody I've ever talked to remembers that because it takes a lot of effort. Is it popular? You bet it's popular, right? Oh, incredibly popular. That's the kind of thing that people remember. It takes an effort to get that reward, and that's the kind of visitor experience that people will remember. Three, it engages multiple senses. I took a kayak trip not too long ago in Alaska, and we're out there on the water, and it's beautiful. Oh, it's gorgeous. And you hear the birds sing, and then the guy leading the trip gets all the kayaks together and hands us each this cookie, this chocolate chip cookie that his mom baked, right? And we're out there in the water eating it, and I'll never forget that. It involved all my senses at once, and there's been a lot of studies that have said the more experiences you involve, the more senses you involve in an experience, the more likely it is to be remembered, and that's just a good thing. And finally, it's worth being talked about. Even if you experience something alone, you have to make your experiences easy to be talked about, whether that's on social media like Twitter or Facebook. And you can have, there's also, have you talked about social media during the days with previous days? So important nowadays to make it easy for your experience to be talked about. Those four things together really will make it important and memorable for people. I didn't talk about this, we don't have time, but I travel a lot. I'm a travel writer. I've kind of done less and less science writing and more travel writing. And I write about these bucket list places all the time. And like they said earlier, I've been all over the world. I just spent a ton of time writing about different things. And the things that I remember the most are things that push me to the right on that curve. They're multisensory, they're easy to talk about. And the second thing, which I'm nervous, so I can't remember right now. Oh, it's hard to do. There's a risk and reward thing. There's a risk and reward payoff. So what did you take away from today's meeting? If you remember that just that one thing, you need to find ways to give NPS visitors opportunities to explore their golden third. There's two ways to do that. Physically, by stretching their personal boundaries through hiking and climbing, walking, exploring. And secondly, intellectual, by challenging your visitors with questions that don't have easy answers. And by providing opportunities to think in new ways through discussion, exhibits, and activities. So when you leave here, maybe at lunch, you can think, talk with your friends, talk with your colleagues about ways to challenge your visitors using all four of, well, challenge your visitors physically, emotionally, not financially, hopefully, but those are the three kinds of risks, physical, emotional, and financial. But at least physically, emotionally, intellectually, talk about that, and you'll really come up with better interpretations. Okay, this is kind of important, maybe. If you send me an email, William@Gurstelle, with the word NPS dash presentation exclamation point in the subject line, it'll automatically send you back notes and references. There's a hyperlink you can click to get my slides, at least some slides. And there'll also be references. So if you don't believe me on that 2D, 4D thing, I'll prove it to you there, okay? You'll see where I'm coming from. And I think I made it without going over too much. Thank you very much for your kind attention. I'll hang around afterwards if you have questions, because I know I now stand between you and lunch. So thank you very much for coming. It was a pleasure to present to you.
Hi, William. I really appreciate your presentation. The last comment you make was really interesting to me. You said, hopefully the National Park Service doesn't make it financially challenging. So we as a group talk about financial limitations and how that's a barrier for various reasons, cultural, socioeconomic, whatever. But as you are suggesting us to take risks, how would you suggest us to look at that financial challenge to get our visitors to then focus on the physical and intellectual?
Okay, there are three types of risk-taking, if you look at it. There's physical risk-taking, there's emotional risk-taking, and there's financial risk-taking. When I talk about financial risk-taking, typically the context I'm talking about is gambling, but betting on a stock, shall I buy this house now or shall I wait? When I think in the context of the National Park Service, maybe you're saying, if I understand your question right, I mean, are you worried that it's going to become too expensive for people to do?
That's what we're, I'm not going to talk for the whole group, but what I'm observing is that the conversation I'm hearing with a lot of my cohort, that we just recently went through a fee change increase. Some parks in this room have actually chosen, and I think have taken a risk, specifically Lorenzo, to not charge fees anymore. Uh-huh. So there are these levels of trying to make adjustments, and maybe that falls into a risk category, to be able to be affordable for people to get.
Okay,
to our
now I get that. And from the I was thinking of it. You're thinking from your standpoint, from the management standpoint,
management
as opposed to
standpoint.
the visitor standpoint.
I'm looking
okay,
at it
got
from
it now.
Management
got
standpoint.
It. Well, I don't know what to. I mean, that's your business. That's why you're all here, and that's why we have the very best people in the mines to work out the various minds in the business to work out those financial questions. I don't have advice on that because that's not something I've considered, and I don't want to just spout something off. Does anybody have a comment to make on that wonderful question that I think is really needs to be asked and answered at some point? Well, we'll think about that. Is there another question in the back?
Yeah, hello. I'm at Zion. So we have Angels Landing and we have the Narrows, and we have a number of fatalities each year.
You have a number of?
I'm sorry, what?
I didn't.
Oh, I'm at Zion. So we have Angels Landing, we have the Narrows, and you know, last year we had perhaps 10 fatalities. This year we've already had one. And I guess for me, the intellectual challenge for visitors, I'm totally game on, but encouraging them to take risks when there is, you know, that fear of danger from the management side, I'm looking at trying to stop some of that.
What a wonderful point, and thank you very much. I am not encouraging anybody to design an experience that is, you know, that there's a possibility of people losing their life. Although it's a national park, and I know people die in national parks all the time. I was kind of thinking of more about your colleague to you, well, to my right, your left. Have you lost anybody on the balcony house? stair climb? No. That's the kind of thing I'm thinking about, where it's a little bit scary, and it's scary enough to be memorable, but I sure don't think that, you know, it's, well, there's a lot of, this is a great question, there's a lot there. I don't think it's good to design exhibits where you're really putting people in physical danger. That said, I know that there's a big controversy, and we talked about this earlier in my presentation, between access and safety. I know people want a free, what do you call it when you jump off with a parachute?
Base jumping?
I know they want to do that in like Yosemite. And, you know, they, so there's a question, do we allow that or do we not allow that? And I wouldn't, you know, I'm not here advocating say, yeah, you got to allow that, that's going to be great. No, you have to make the very calculated, important decisions based on that. But I do believe if you're not at a place like Zion or, I mean, there was talking to somebody who had an interpreter of, you know, Indian ruins or Civil War battlefields. I'm thinking there are ways at least to make it difficult, if not dangerous, and therefore more memorable to have those kinds of tours. I guess that's where I'm coming from. But I sure don't want to say, yeah, you should make it easier for people to get hurt. That's not where I'm coming from.
No, and I understand that. And I know that most people don't think of that. But whenever you use the word bucket list, you know, it is something that to make sure that somebody just doesn't put on their bucket list and they go do it without being prepared. And we have had at least 2 fatalities, maybe 3 for base jumping at Zion.
Is that legal there?
No. But we haven't, you know, it still happens. But, you know, just is the whole bucket list type idea of somebody just writing it down and then going and doing it, is that we need to make sure whatever we do that those people are prepared for the climb, for the, you know, that kind of thing. That was all I was saying.
I think that's a wonderful point. Does anybody have a comment on that? Okay.
And actually, this is more just to kind of reinforce the idea that you were trying to make with that ladder at Balcony House. It's not particularly dangerous at all, but it's been really fun to watch the people who are not really comfortable doing it, but they challenge themselves to do it, or their family members drag them up it, as the case may be. But at the end of those tours, when those people have done that, you can see that it really made a difference. It was really an exciting adventure for them, whereas most of us would go, really? It's a ladder. It's not that big a deal. But to them, it's a huge, huge deal. So yeah, I see where you're saying push to the right. One other quick example, due to some concession contracting things, we had a tram out on Wetherill Mesa. We no longer have that. So we chose to make it a biking and hiking area instead of the tram. So now to do, for instance, tours of Longhouse, it's instead of being a relatively quick walk down there, it's a 2.25-mile round trip hike that pushes people just a little bit more. So I think that's the kind of things you're talking about.
That is the kind of thing I'm talking about. So thank you for that excellent example. And I always use Mesa Verde as an example because that's so clear in my mind as something that's so memorable that people remember for the rest of their lives. Madam.
I would suppose that possibly sometimes the physical challenge is really more of a reflection of somebody's emotional challenge. And I've seen people come to our park site and hike up to the cliff dwellings. Somebody was a stage 4 cancer patient, and she wanted to make it, and she made it. And many people who do not have those physical barriers don't challenge themselves emotionally and intellectually and don't put themselves in that physical challenge, that it's really more of a state of their intellectual, emotional state of being able to make that hike.
Thank you for that. Are there any other questions or comments? There are.
So I work at Glen Canyon National Recreation Area, where people love to do risky things that can kill you, like jump off of cliffs that are higher than 15 feet tall, which is the legal max. And they also like to go swimming in marinas where you can get electrocuted. So we came up with a super creative campaign that basically just said, these things can kill you and this is why. But I'm wondering if understanding the psychology of those maybe more extreme risk takers, what they think the reward is, why they're not concerned about the cost, and if there's any type of message that would be effective at getting through to them based on how they think and why they do what they do?
There are a group of people way off to the right-hand side of that risk-taking curve. They're even beyond the Nellie Blys, and they do irrational things just for the sake of thrill-seeking. And, you know, why do they do it? Okay, my research shows is that your brain is basically a soup of chemicals, and there's all these chemicals inside that are working, some of them such as dopamine, and I can't remember the other ones, in some people, like the heroin junkies with a death wish. You're not going to get through to them. People jumping, you're saying they jump off 50-foot cliffs into water or what? Oh, into water, okay. Yeah. Sorry? When somebody jumps off a 90-foot cliff, they die. So how do you reach those people? It's very difficult because they're not like the normal people. How much, I don't know, I'm just talking off the cuff here. How much time and money can you spend preventing people, a very small group? It's not like everybody's going to come there and do it. There's a small group of people whose brains work differently, who seek, who need this kind of adventure and this kind of thrill-seeking. And how much can you do to really prevent that? Explain the warning, explain the risks, make it difficult, put up barriers. But at some point, what can you do? I don't know of any studies that show this is how you reach those people. If they were successful with that, they would do a better job controlling illegal drug use and the bad sexual practices and so forth. It's very difficult.
I think we have time for maybe one or two more.
Okay. Hi, I just have just a couple comments. One is the perception of risk, and I would argue that one of the questions was backpacking in the wilderness. And statistically, you know, if you look at, well, what are the real risks? What do people die of? You know, heart disease is a far more common killer than being mauled by a grizzly bear while hiking alone in bear country. So there's that whole perception issue.
Perception, exactly.
And then the other comment I have is that one of the things that we have in our agency, my observation is that most of our employees are probably in the golden third of that bell curve.
Exactly.
And our agency is kind of all the way on the left. And I think that that's a major factor that explains some of the issues we have around our employee satisfaction.
That is such a wonderful comment, and it's the first time that's been raised with me ever. Here you are in the field, and you saw where you are. You skew to the right. You skew over here. Yet you've got a bureaucracy, managers and so forth, that are in a completely different place. And how you have to manage that relationship, knowing that your risk levels, your thrill-seeking tolerance is different than theirs, that's something that takes a lot of thought. And good luck on that.
What I understood there was that the vast majority of the visiting public actually fell into that Thomas Cook range.
The vast majority, well, the majority, between 40 and 65% are Thomas Cook type travelers.
Yeah, and I get the whole idea of pushing them towards that risk taking. I would ask you, you know, for suggestions on maybe keeping them within that range, but making those visits. What are some tactics, some strategies to keep them within their comfort zone, but yet continue to make that visit memorable without, you know, pushing them?
Exactly. And I don't really want to keep them in their comfort zone. And you can do that with intellectual risk taking. This is the, I know the parks that you come from. They're beautiful, they're huge. They're not Civil War parks. But when people come to those parks, you can ask, at least my experience in answering that question at least, is with parks that aren't all about physical beauty and mountains and rivers and ruins, but more like, important houses of famous people, national shrines out east. How do you get people to be uncomfortable, at least out of their comfort zone in those areas? You ask hard questions, and you force them to think about it. Who is an American? Why is this person named, why is this place named this instead of this? And those are the kinds of things that you can do without putting people in physical risk, is you intellectually make your exhibits challenging to people, and if you can add in, I say, an element of physical your kind of physical risk, not your kind of physical risk, that's even better, because that's what people will remember. It's multisensory then, and so forth. Well, thank you. I'm glad we had time for questions. There's, I guess if I have a minute, do I have a minute?
1 minute?
1 minute. So one thing I sometimes talk about, and you mentioned this, madam, in the back, is this idea of a bucket list. And I hate that term. I'd rather call it a life list. I like the term life list, and I actually put together my own life list. And I think it's something that is good for anybody, especially any traveler, and maybe for you. You make a list of things that you want to see and do while you're alive, not in order to die, but you know, to do that. And you kind of choose the things based on challenge, both intellectual and physical, and multisensory, you know, how many different things can we do? You know, I want to see every painting by Vermeer before I die. I would love to climb McKinley. That's not going to happen at my age. I made a vow. I wanted to be in a TV game show. I did that. You know, there's all these things that you can do and your visitors can do. And you might kind of explore the idea of not a bucket list, but a life list, and put that out there for people as a group. Put it out there for people, and you can do this as a group for different parks. But everybody in their life should climb Angel's Landing. Everybody in their life should go to try that balcony house thing, or see or understand. Is there somebody who was at Anasazi Ruins? We talked. What was your thing? Petroglyphs. You know, and find out what's really important about that. Not everybody's bucket list is going to include that, but a lot of people's are. And if you make it known what's bucket list worthy, life list worthy, that's an important thing. Okay, I think my time really is up now. Thank you very much for your kind attention.